Now, the Monster Buck Profile, featuring the Hanson Buck.
I'm sitting with Milo Hanson, and Milo, this is an incredible deer, and appreciate you letting me come up here and take a look at it.
Well, thanks, Bill, for coming up here. And
Pretty nice deer.
He is a nice deer.
it really is. You know, I know in talking to you and visiting with you the last several weeks, your whole life has changed. And I know that before November 23rd to right now, a lot of things have happened.
Oh, that's for sure. Before the 23rd, like, you know, just normal every day was farming and stuff like that. And now things have turned completely around. Phones ringing, magazines wanting promoters, artists.
Hey, well, you know, tell me about the scoring. You know, you had at the ceremony for the official scoring about 400 or 500 people. I know you had a few anxious moments with all those people out there.
Yeah, it was fairly nervous, you know. Not because I was scared that, you know, this was going to shrink down below the Jordan buck, but just the excitement of the whole thing with all these people there. It was, you know, really nice. The people all showed out for it, but it was nervous.
Quite a night. You know, speaking of the Jordan buck, you know, I talked about it earlier in the opening. You know, that buck was taken in 1914 and scored 206 and 1/8. Did you ever have an idea or a thought living up here in Canada that you might possibly be the world record holder one day?
No, never. No, yeah. It never dawned on me till probably a week after I shot it.
Right.
It dawned on me.
It didn't start to come to you a little bit.
That's for sure.
Well, you know, talking about hunting this deer was actually seen last year, you know, before this year's hunting season.
Yeah, our local bus driver, Jim Angelopoulos, had actually seen them in 92, last couple of days of the hunting season.
Mm-hmm.
And then one of our neighbors spotted him the next summer in his one of his bluffs close to his yard, and he told me what, you know, what this deer looked like, So when the 93 season opened up, we went specifically looking for this deer.
Right. This deer was actually seen by a lot of people the start of this past hunting season, 93 season, and he was actually hunting pretty hard, I guess you say, from the bow hunters and also your muzzle loading season. And, you know, he made it through there, and then when November 15th came around, I think that was the opening of your season, you guys started hunting it.
Yeah, oh yeah, that morning, well, we started Sunday night, phoned everybody that wanted to come, you know, with our hunting party, and we planned our strategy, or we're going to do it, the morning of November 15th, we headed right to the area where he was last seen, and we started looking for him, We went to high advantage points there, and actually, we never spotted him in the morning that time at all,
Right.
So we wandered away a little bit and came back just 15, 20 minutes before the legal hunting time ended, and one of my buddies, Walter, spotted him,
Right.
But he was sitting on a track of posted land there, so we couldn't do much with
him. Couldn't hunt with him down there, right. Well, that takes us through the 17th. Now, take us on from there the next time that you saw the deer.
We never actually seen him till probably, I think, like I never did see him, but Walter seen him again on Thursday, just to glimpse him.
Mm-hmm.
And so we, same thing, tried to find out where he went. And that was the day that when we were looking for him, we ran across a nice, I'd say probably it'd be a 160.
Right.
And both me and Walter, you know, had our guns up and cocked. And no, that wasn't him,
That's hard to pass up a 160 for a lot of people,
It was close. Like I had my finger on the trigger and, you know, ready to pull it.
Right. On Monday, you had to go to work with, that kind of a hard decision to go to work instead of going after this nice deer?
Yeah, it was, but there was no fresh snow, you know, and...
A little bit hard to track.
Hard to track and stuff, so I had to stay home because you had to get some work. The wife, you know.
Yeah, I can understand.
He headed on to probably another 30 acres or 40 acres of willows, so we had to make another plan how we're going to get him out of there, with one driver and...
Right.
And three guys covering the sides, And I was on the north side, northwest side, sort of. And Rennie was on the, tracking them through, and Walter was on the east side, And that's when I first seen him, like 150 yards when he came up, broadside. I guess that's when I got buck fever, because that's when I missed a really good shot.
I tell you and everybody else.
Yeah.
Okay, and you missed on that shot.
Yeah, broadside, you know. But I mean, he was running like wide open, but. Missed him, and he went into another bluff, and he went straight through that one into another track of land that I got kitty cornering this one in.
Right.
We moved up to where we had seen him go in, and planned our, you know, the way we're going to do it. And this is when he ran out of this one, is when he ran out and he headed west onto my land there. And I just seen the back end of him and his horns, like, really mm-hmm. impressive. And that's when I took another shot at him and I hit the top of his rib cage and part of the bullet shrapnel, the horn, eh? And that's when he actually went down onto his knees, eh?
And that's the reason that tape's up there, but that's a whole nother story. All right, now, the deer went down, then what happened?
Yeah, then he went to another small bluff there, eh?
Right.
Sort of a hole in the thing, eh? And so I moved up there, and that's when I seen him. And
right.
I administered a shot through his neck, and it, I was up higher, and it went through his neck and into his shoulder, eh?
Right.
And then he sort of disappeared, eh? I didn't know if he dropped right there or moved into the thicker willows, eh? So I ran down there right away and...
And then one more shot after finished him off.
I could see his head just above the willows, eh? So he administers a shot. And
there he went. And then the record's yours.
Yeah.
You had a lot of people coming out wanting to see this deer. When did you actually realize that you may have a true trophy on your hands?
Every day there was more trucks coming into our yard and you know, looking at, and we weren't even home some of the time. You know,
that deer's just out there.
He sat there in the shop, eh? So then on Sunday, Adam Ivashenko, he was up hunting moose, and he came back from hunting moose, eh? And he came over for supper that night, eh? And he used to measure for the Bigger Wildlife Federation here, so after supper he put the tape on it and measured it, and he came up with 214, and he said, I don't know. Said, either I made a mistake or you have the world or next world record.
And then the knees started coming together.
That's
do it,
sure.
Really. Yeah.
So then it went from there. We phoned Bruce Kushner. He put the tape on it on Monday, and he came up with 214 and something. 214 and I think it was 6/8.
Right.
And they had the same reaction. He said, I don't know, I think I did something wrong. He said, maybe we should go out and remeasure it. Right. And I said, well, what'd you get? And he said, 214 and 4/6. And I said, well, no, you're pretty close, because Adam came up with 214, eh?
Right.
And that's when he started hauling out all his record books, eh? And that's when we really knew that...
They had something.
We had something, eh? You know, the world record.
Well, let me tell you, it's been a real treat for us, you know, ever since you and I got together, and of course, Olive, and David Blanton, and it's been a real treat. And everybody that I know that knows you, you're a well-deserving person for this deer, and I do want to congratulate you. And I'm not even envious much.
Well, thank you, Bill.
But this is a great deer, and I tell you, I want to wish you the best for this deer for years to come, and it's to a well-deserving person.
Let's recap quickly. The Hanson buck is the new world record typical, scoring 213 and an eighth Boone and Crockett. It was harvested by Milo Hanson near Bigger, Saskatchewan on November 23, 1993, and replaces the James Jordan buck, which was taken in 1914 as the new number one by 6 inches. The longest tine measures 14 inches, and the inside spread is 27 2/8 inches. Incredibly, the Hanson buck was aged at only 3.5 years old.